Good afternoon, where we are in the afternoon, I think, in both evening time zones now at this point. I'm Dr. Miriam Nyhan-Gray, and I'm co-convening with my colleague Kim DaCosta this wonderful conference, Where Do We Go From Here? Revisiting Black-Irish Relations and Responding to a Transnational Moment. We have a fabulous panel lined up for the next hour or so, and I'm going to hand it over to our wonderful colleague in cinema studies, Anna McCarthy, who's going to introduce and moderate our the next session. Anna is professor and chair of cinema studies at NYU and editor of the journal Social Text Online. In addition to academic books and essays, she has written for Interview, The Nation, and Avidly, a channel of the LARB. Her current research focuses on the activities of the Catholic Church in Irish television. So I hand it over to you, Anna. Thank you so much.
Thanks very much, Miriam. I'm delighted to be here. And I was particularly, I was telling Chanté before we opened, I was particularly happy to get the opportunity to see this film, which I'd never heard of. And it's quite amazing. And its credit sequence is done by these really interesting animators who I didn't know did that. So anyway, thank you everyone for coming. The conference has been really great so far, and I think we'll have a great session now. Chanté Mouton Kinyon is currently an assistant professor of English at the University of Notre Dame. Her primary research explores transnational African-American literature and culture with a particular interest in the ways African-American culture and literature intersect in the ways intersect with Irish culture and literature. Her book project studies the influential representation Irish and American African-American artists have had on each other while theorizing the ways in which these artists signified and conceptualized race and marginality. The 2019 to 2021 Moreau postdoctoral fellow, Kinyon was previously the 2018 to 2019 NEH fellow at the Keogh Norton Institute for Irish Studies and a four-year recipient of the Galway Research Fellowship for Doctoral Studies. Forthcoming, Kinyon's article, Foregrounding Lost Rituals and the Transatlantic Gesture, The Keen, The Cakewalk, and Disappearing Cultural Practices, will be published in Modern Drama in 2021, as will the introduction she wrote for Black Matters, African-American College Students and Graduates Tell Their Life Stories, a book currently under contract with Cornell University Press. So her work is pretty amazing, and we're all looking forward to hearing from her. I'll turn it right over to you, Chanté, and your beautiful cat in the background.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. So I'm just going to share my screen. I'll be talking about UpTight 1968 today. Catherine mentioned it, Anna mentioned that she just saw the film. It's a film that most people, or a lot of people, haven't seen. It kind of was in the theater and then out pretty quickly because of the reviews. So I have a couple of clips for you during the presentation. Originally titled The Betrayal, on April 4th, 1968, UpTight's script was altered again. Jill Stassen, the exiled and blacklisted film director of the film noir era, stopped shooting and flew with a crew to Atlanta, Georgia, to capture Keene's funeral procession on film. Initially conceived as a remake of John Ford's film, The Informer, the national tragedy Keene's assassination triggered in America prompted screenwriters Stassen, Ruby Dee, and Julian Mayfield to rewrite the script again. Speaking at a 2008 screening of the film at the Brooklyn Academy of Music as part of the Afropunk Festival, Dee stated that the three co-writers rewrote and reshot some of the film to reflect what had just happened.
Children, don't get weary. Children, don't you get weary. Don't get weary. Hear your word.
Was brought in by Paramount to make an all-Black version of what is considered to be Ford's cinematic masterpiece. In this role, Dassin attempted to write a script that was both faithful to the original film, but also the auteur wanted to present a film that realistically depicted Black American life, from their struggles with the white American police force to intercommunal conflicts between Black activists. Yet, as Dassin developed that project, he felt ill-equipped to write the script. By April of 1968, writers, actors, and activists, Ruby Dee and Julian Mayfield, had been brought onto the project to help with the script development. In regards to the new title, Dee said that, quote, "Jules was very pleased when the new title was suggested. It was an uptight time. Being Black in America is an uptight situation." In Uptight, the frustration that structural change has not been achieved for Black America is demonstrated through the performances of each of its characters. The Black characters in the film are poor, hungry, angry, brooding, disenfranchised, and haunted by reality that even though significant advances have been made in the civil rights movement, King's assassination and the riots that exploded around the country afterwards reflect that Black lives are still significantly impacted by a racist American society. In the melodramatic thriller, a group of Black revolutionaries, referred to as the Committee, has decided to take up arms in hopes that a violent revolt will change the racist political structure of America. In the wake of King's assassination, the Committee is more committed to radicalization. Quote, "The man from Love got his head shot out," spits out Janie, one of the committee members, "and all those people learned nothing." The committee's co-leader, BG, portrayed by Raymond St. John, replies, "Death is a fast teacher. They'll learn. It's clearer now."
We honor the great multitude that followed that mule train in order and in dignity in Atlanta.
Cry, march, pray. That's the way to win Whitey's heart. Free at last. Free to stop begging.
No, baby. In his way, he was a fighter.
He was a beggar. The man from love. Well, the man from love got his head shot off. And all those people learn nothing.
Death is a fast teacher.
Dassin had planned to shoot the film in the borough he grew up in, Harlem, New York, but moved the location to Cleveland, Ohio, because he wanted the film to reflect a more typical American city, rather than a place audiences would assume race relations were already problematic. As Christopher Civic writes in Soul Searching, Black-themed cinema from the March on Washington to the rise of Black exploitation, Dassin wanted viewers to understand the depth of race relations problem in US cities in general, not just the familiar trouble spots. Speaking to the Ohio Plain Dealer in August of 68, Dassin said, "I brought the story to Cleveland because I think Cleveland is more representative of a big American city than any other. Filmed in an inner city neighborhood known as Huff, which had experienced deadly riots in 1966, brought on by economic desolation, Dassin's honest film reflects an unraveling community. In the film, the neighborhood of tenements, rundown motels, and bars sits next to the city's steel mills and industrial infrastructure. A failed gun armory heist on the night of King's funeral sets up the betrayal that dictates the direction UpTight takes. Tank, played by Mayfield, and UpTight's Jippo Nolan, is unemployed after being fired from the steel mill he worked at for 20 years. Previously respected within the community for his role as a union organizer, Tank was dismissed from the mill for challenging an abusive white man. At the start of the film, Tank is an alcoholic, presently drunk and distraught after spending the day in front of the television watching King's funeral. Tank's childhood friend, Johnny, a militant member of the committee, asked Tank to join them in stealing weapons, but Tank refuses to join. He says, "Not tonight, Johnny." Johnny and the other committee members disagree. More than ever, tonight. Undermanned, the heist takes longer than their group had planned. And as a result, Johnny kills a guard during the break-in, an event that forces him into hiding. Blamed for Johnny's predicament, Tank is castigated out of the committee by BG and other. And from Tank's perspective, he is ostracized by Johnny as well. This betrayal leads Tank to another. Tank informs on his friend for a $1,000 reward.
Night. Wrong night, guys! Call it off! Get out of here! Blow! I don't want to see you! Call it off! Call it off! I don't want nothing to do with you, Johnny! Go ahead. Call him white man's nigger now. He can't hear you. Go away, Johnny, please! Please. And I feel. No, you don't, Johnny. I never felt so bad in all my life. Come on, Dad. Come on. Or you wouldn't go back on the juice tank.
What's the difference?
Damn. Listen to him. He was a big man. BG always said so. Even Corbin said so. But he was holding us back. And Memphis proves the answer is guns, more guns. Tonight's on. Without me, with you. We'd plan every move with you. We need you.
Tonight, Johnny?
More than ever tonight.
Tomorrow. Tomorrow, please.
It's not the first time you let us down, is it, Tank?
Lemuel Flattery became a popular literary figure with the publication of his third and still best known novel, The Informer. Originally published in 1925, the novel is the first of four books of Flattery focuses on in Dublin, the dreary antithesis to Gorton Gopal, the village he was originally from on Inishmore. Set in the aftermath of the Irish Civil War, The Informer follows Jippo Nolan, a former Dublin police officer who, at the beginning of the novel, is now living on the margins. Brought into utter shame and poverty, first by being fired as a police officer for being in league with the Irish Revolutionary Organization, and then expelled from said revolutionary organization for disobeying direct orders. One of the reasons The Informer's continued popularity is due to the film remake O'Flattery's cousin made in 1935. John Ford's version of The Informer was nominated for six categories at the 1936 Academy Awards, the eighth celebration for artistic and technical accomplishments in the movie industry. Ford's The Informer won the most awards for the night. Max Steiner won an Oscar for Best Musical Score. Dudley Nichols won for Best Screenplay. Victor McLagan, the film's Jippo Nolan, won for Best Actor, and John Ford won for Best Director. Ford's version was the second film remake of the novel, and of the four filmic versions made, Ford's film remains the most popular. Yet, while Ford's version remains the most well-known and successful version of The Informer, I argue that the 1968 film UpTight, directed by Jules Dassin and co-written by Dassin, Ruby Dee, and Julian Mayfield, functions as the most faithful adaptation of O'Flattery's text. Ford's film romanticizes his parents' homeland, plays up the Irish as victims of the British, and sells America as a space of spiritual renewal. In fact, unlike the novel, America plays a central role in Ford's The Informer. In the 1935 film, America is presented as a country that promises freedom, freedom from oppression, freedom from strife, and most importantly, freedom from one's past. However, UpTight, similar to the novel it's based on, is void of romance, hope, and promise. By the end of UpTight, while Tank feels redeemed for betraying his best friend, the viewer is left in doubt about what lies ahead for the two Black political factions depicted in the film. The Black radical revolutionaries and the conservative Black assimilationists. Much like O'Flattery's text, which ends with Jippo redeemed and forgiven by Francis's mother, but laying still with blood gushing from his mouth, UpTight too leaves the viewer anxious and uneasy as Tank's dead body lies in the still yard. UpTight, which essentially has an all-Black cast, follows O'Flattery's novel more closely than the other films. Arthur Robinson's version, a 1929 silent film, considered by film curator Bernie Dixon to be one of the best films of the silent era, captures the German expressionism O'Flattery wrote into the text, but sanitizes O'Flattery's novel by taking out all aspects of politics and ethnicity. As Pat Sheeran notes in The Informer, Ireland into film, the plot of Robinson's film has little to do with the novel. Ford's The Informer has plenty of politics and contains more elements from the novel, but he stages his film in the midst of the struggles of the Irish War of Independence, rather than focusing on the aftermath of the Irish Civil War, which is at the heart of O'Flattery's novel. And the 1992 amateur production by Michael Byrne, which I believe can only be viewed at the Irish Film Archive in Dublin, while ambitious, is forced to restrict the plot to a tightly constructed linear narrative. UpTight is generally seen as a failure by film historians and critics. When it premiered December 1968, the reviews were either mixed or completely unfavorable. In regards to the cast, nearly all the critics praised their talents as actors. Julian Mayfield's performance is typically highlighted as particularly dynamic. Kathy Aldridge wrote in December of 68 that the film had, quote, a superb cast, and that Mayfield releases an enormous talent on an unsuspecting audience. Archer Winston wrote that in the same month, that there were good performances in UpTight by Raymond St. Jux as BG, the Negro leader of the militants, Julian Mayfield as Tank, the informer, Roscoe Lee Brown as Clarence, the surly police operative, Frank Silvera as Kyle, the conservative Negro leader, and Ruby Dee as mother, part-time prostitute, and Tank's girlfriend. And in January of 1969, Seymour Peck wrote in a thank you note to Mayfield that included a personal postscript that he thought very highly of UpTight and of Mayfield's work in it. Yet, other viewers who were familiar with and loved Ford's 1935 version, these critics seemed specifically annoyed that The Informer had been remade with a Black cast. So while many of the reviews praised the film's acting and its actors, they lambasted the project overall. Joseph Morgenstern, who titled his review Misinformer, opens the review by referring to Jules Dassin as, quote, the white nigger in the woodpile. Using the offensive idiom that suggests something important is being poorly concealed, Morgenstern goes on to write that Dassin's critical mistake was probably his first, the decision to color a white story black. The parallels between Irish revolutionists of the 1920s and Black revolutionists of today are seductive, largely suspicious, or irrelevant. The Informer wasn't a socio-political study of an era. It didn't tax its audience with rhetoric about the IRA's eternal divisions or the Black and Tan's hypocrisies. It was an elegantly simple story of personal guilt, a story about an informer. Gippo Nolan, played so magnificently by Victor McLaven, was a starving, underbrained buffoon of a derelict and the object of real compassion when he turned to his captors and cried, "Is there a man here who can tell me why I did it?" Another critic who reviewed the film in 68 berated Dassin for basing his film on The Informer and thereby setting up an implicit comparison between, quote, the noble history of the Irish struggle for independence and such a paltry thing as Black insurgency in America's inner cities. Famed film critic Roger Ebert wrote in February 69 that Dassin made a strategic error at the very beginning when he chose UpTight as a remake of The Informer, Lemo Flattery's novel and John Ford's film about the Irish Revolution. The transplant doesn't work. The Irish and Black revolutions have little in common, either in methods or in style. French film critics Jean-Pierre Cordesson and Bertrand Tavernier write in 50 ans de cinéma américain that UpTight is only a lamentable new version of a film that was already old-fashioned, here stupidly rejuvenated. Irish rebels have been replaced by Black activists without making the thing seem any more realistic. On the contrary, it all goes by so fast that you have the impression of being at a parody of some naturalist theater piece, 1930s Clifford Odette style. Film critics and historians have also at times rejected UpTight as a Black film. Rebecca Prime notes in her introduction from Blacklist to Black Films, The Hollywood Radicals Return Home, that even though UpTight is a film that explores Black topics, it has largely been neglected by scholars of African-American film. She writes that Donald Bogle, Daniel Lebb, and Thomas Cripps all refer to UpTight who do not discuss the film in depth in their books on Black cinema. And Ed Guerrero, Mark Reed, and Mancha Diaria failed to mention the film at all in their work on fact film. In Soul Searching 2011, Christopher Stivig writes that Uptight was irrelevant in terms of cultural nationalism because representations of African-American culture, cultural practices are almost completely absent from the film. And because its conception and execution, the film largely failed to satisfy the then developing criteria for legitimately Black culture and aesthetics. Certainly, there may be more tangible and elementary factors behind Uptight's quick disappearance, but its maker's failure to accurately gauge prevailing social attitudes, the film's raison d'etre, effectively repelled even those film goers who were most receptive to the Black power idea. I object to how critics have either ignored or negatively critiqued Uptight. From the critics who dismissed the film as a substandard remake of Ford's classic, to the critics who dismissed Uptight as a racially insignificant film of the civil rights era. The vast majority of Uptight's critics do not seem to recognize the major changes Ford's film made to O'Flaherty's novel when screenwriter Dudley Nichols adapted the script. The novel and the 1935 film are not concerned with the same moments in Irish history. The novel reflects frustration with a newly forming republic. The novel is dark. It captures a depressed and disparate nation, a nation struggling in the aftermath of a civil war. By moving the time back to the Irish War of Independence, changing the antagonists from internal adversaries to external enemies, Ford's film simplifies the contentiousness present in O'Flaherty's text. As Lance Petit writes in Screening Ireland, Ford avoids the awkwardness of Jitbo's lover betraying him to the IRA. Ford's changes work to shift focus away from Flattery's interest in the dissensual internal conflict implicit in a civil war, substituting it with an overarching narrative solution of Catholic redemption for the individual moral weakness of Jitbo. Unlike Ford's film, which most of the critics are measuring Uptight against, Dassin's film relied more on the novel to tell its story. Dassin, Dee, and Mayfield used the two representations of Irish conflict and repackaged them in an American context, an Afro-American context, producing a film that only carries the importance of what O'Flaherty articulates in his text. Uptight also carries the importance of what Dassin, Dee, and Mayfield wanted validated in the film. Moreover, while the previous film versions of The Informer concentrated on character development, Uptight leans on the social commentary present in O'Flaherty's text and builds on it to tell a narrative about Black America. By bristling at the implicit insinuation that the Black and Irish struggles are in any way aligned, Uptight's critics miss specific nuances of Irish history in their condemnation. It is not that I am claiming that the Irish and Afro-American experiences are the same. There are many differences between Ireland and Afro-America, and a multitude of ways in which the histories and cultures of these two groups diverge. More importantly, within production of Uptight, I do not think Dassin, Dee, and Mayfield were suggesting that the Afro-American and Irish political struggles mirrored each other. Rather, what I argue and what I suggest the artists were grappling with is that there are intriguing similarities between the Irish and Black questions. Perhaps by engaging in a project that aligns the socio-political struggles of two different cultures, two different peoples, the makers of Uptight were making a statement on commonalities that could be seen between Black Americans and their fellow white citizens. Rather than focus on what differentiates, as the reviewer said, the noble history of the Irish struggle for independence and such a paltry thing as Black insurgency in America's inner cities. Dasin, Dee, and Mayhill were asking their audience to focus on the fact that the struggle against oppression can unite each of us across boundaries. I also struggle with the claims by critics of UpTight, arguing that the film lacks genuine references to Black American culture. Yes, the film does remake an Irish novel and an Irish American film with a Black audience to guide the plot of the story. Yet, I suggest that the film is struggling to understand how Black Americans exist in their home country. This is a sentiment that not only resonates in O'Flaherty's book, it is also one that anticipates an articulation of Frank Wilderson's understanding of social death. Significant advances in civil rights have been made, but the Blacks in the film are still captured in a form of slavery. UpTight presents an authentic depiction of 1968, a cultural moment significantly transformed and ruptured. At what moment there is a future of possibility and hope, and at the next, society was stalled. As Claudia Rankine states in Blackness as the Second Person, an interview she has with Mira Sharma that discusses everyday racism, the violence inherent in language, and the continuum from Rodney King to Michael Brown, a narrative like UpTight captures the disappointing moment where the past is the present, is the future. UpTight uses an Irish story from the early 20th century as its skeleton. But in the end, it captures a mid 20th century Black suffering. UpTight is a harsh tale about a tense nation deciding how to continue forward. Violent self-destruction or accept an anti-violent approach with the hopes of unifying a nation. It is also a film that speaks to our current moment and frames a Black nation arrested in social death. Yeah, while UpTight as a film might share Wilderson's Afro-pessimistic vision, it also complicates the narrative because it replicates an Irish project with Black bodies in the hopes that the analogy about anti-Black racism and violence might inspire empathy in its white audience. There's another clip I wanted to play for you, but it doesn't look like it's going to play. No, it's not going to play. Thank you.
Thank you, Chanté. I hope that the internet remains stable for me. I had a little bit of an issue, and maybe you did too, Chanté, if you're having video playing issues. So please bear with us if we have any.
Sorry about that. There was another clip. It's a clip from the film that it talks about what white liberals can do for a Black community. It's actually a really beautiful scene in the film. And I actually think it plays to this current moment because what I feel like I learned about 2020 is that was like a reminder to white liberal America and white liberals around the world that the struggle still continues. I don't think I learned anything new from what was happening over the last year from the summer of 2020, so.
And that scene is very interesting because it's a film by a white director and it's in the scene, if it's the one I'm thinking of, these revolutionaries pretty firmly kick out their one white ally.
Yeah.
And he's like, I was with you in Selma, you know, and he names Goodman Tremortain. They're like, no, you're out now. We can't, this is a different moment. And that is a really interesting way that, you know, as a white character, he's sort of self-marginalizing or trying to perhaps cover his butt. We don't know. I mean, in some ways those things work together within, you know, notions of allyship or accompliceship in today. So I really appreciate your bringing it up today, especially because it resonates so much with a film like Judas and the Black Messiah, which came out in 2021 and is the story of Bill O'Neill, the informer whose activities led to the death of Fred Hampton. That murder happened a year after this film was released, right? And if you look at the moment historically, you've also got in Ireland the kind of stepping up of the struggles for civil rights in which start out as a civil rights movement, one man, one job, in the early part of the 60s, in the troubles with Catholics demanding equality, which then leads to the very complex late 60s, early 70s situation in the North, where by the end of that period, many people were dead and informers had infiltrated the entire movement. I think in some ways, this film speaks to 1968 as this scene of intense, what Althusser would call overdetermination, where all of these contradictions are building up in the social system internationally. So we have rebels in the United Kingdom, we have rebels in Cleveland, the United Kingdom on the Ireland, on the island of Ireland, I should say. So it's really interesting that the film is so, it's so interesting that it begins with a funeral, because of course an Irish viewer would instantly think Bloody Sunday, which happens in 1972. So again, that sort of speaks to that, the intensity of that moment. I think it's also really interesting that, this is a Ford remake, because it's not the only effort to take the work of John Ford and transform it for more revolutionary or alternate ends. So there's a film called Searchers by the Inuit filmmaker Zacharias Kunuk, and it's a remake of the film The Searchers with John Wayne, one of the most racist films in American film canon, and it's a all Inuit cast. It doesn't even care about the actual originary text of The Searchers very much. It's really interested in taking the historical knowledge that it wants to transmit through its film narrative and showing a kind of different version of the Inuit, of the indigenous experience without worrying about Europeans. So that's, it's interesting to think about Ford, kind of such a problematic director, being recuperated within American cinema and or North American cinema. I have one question for you, which I mean, I could speak more about this, but I think also the French Resistance is coming back in a very interesting way. The resistance from World War II is coming back in a kind of, in the critique of Charles de Gaulle that's happening in the late 60s and 68 in France. So films like Army of Shadows, very influential film now, were dismissed because they were seen as Gaullist and pro-French, sort of like anti-resistance in, or conservative in their politics. So the whole notion of what resistance was in France, what it was in England slash the United Kingdom slash the island of Ireland slash the American urban locale is just fascinating to me. You've really discovered something really cool here. And it just, my one question is really, why does the film use drunkenness as the moral measure of tank? Because I don't know the novel, but it's definitely not really the big thing in The Informer. It's not what's the moral, it's not how Gippo fails to live up to the expectations of the revolution. So is that just a crude kind of stereotyping of Irishness?
It's a crude
way of referencing the...
It's a part of the novel in the sense that Gippo doesn't inform because he's drunk, but when he informs and gets the money, he's the whole idea behind the inform, like him informing, is that he's gonna, it's 20 pounds for him and Katie to go to America. And so they're gonna take the 40 pounds for turning in Francis and go to America. But what he does is he goes to the bar, the pub instead, and starts drinking. And so his, I mean, and everybody informs differently in each of the films. In the novel, Gippo, he just, I mean, he basically sees Francis, he's hungry and feeling rejected, and he sees the opportunity to make some money. And so, but, and, yeah. And that's why in the Ford film, it takes the betrayal. Like he feels like Gippo in Ford's estimation, it's not only just because Francis is there, it's that he really wants to save Katie from being a prostitute. So there, and then this pool that in America, he can become something else and she can become something else, right? She won't have to prostitute herself anymore. And so that's when I say that Dassin and Dee and Mayfield really take both versions of the film or both versions of the project and make it a one. That's what they're doing, right? They're taking Ford's kind of making, there's another reason for informing, and also this idea that when you inform, you spend the money recklessly. So that's where the drinking is coming from. I mean, I'm also thinking that this is a society that's been devastated by what's happening around them as well. And so I think Tank becomes an alcoholic and starts to drink because he's lost hope. He's lost his sense of purpose. He was working at the steel mill for all these years. He was a unionist and, you know, and then he loses his job for doing the right thing. And now he has no purpose. And so he turns to alcohol. So he feels, he feels let down by the society. You know?
Yeah.
There's a question here. Do you feel that the government provocateur actions in Ireland, arming and advancing of the Provo IRA and the terrorist loyalist groups is parallel to the provocateur actions of in disrupting the US revolutionary movement, i.e. advancing Cleaver Black Liberation Army faction and the Black Panther as discussed in TJ Lee? And also the
American- I think the question is really, is the state operating through these sort of extrajudicial means, using networks of human beings in these different places? Would you agree? I think we're all socialists here, and we say yes.
I mean, I would say that it's definitely, it's one thing that draws me into looking at what was happening in Ireland while similar things and similar activities were happening in America, right? Like, they can be looked at similarly and analyzed within the same context, absolutely.
Kim DaCosta is asking, can you say more about why the critics were so unable to see the parallels between Irish and Black political movement? Yeah, they seem obvious, right? What about the politics of film criticism shaped that reaction? Great question.
Joe Morgenstern, who actually is still an active film critic right now, his review was particularly offensive. And why, I think one of the reasons why that the reviews were so harsh in terms of seeing parallels between the Irish situation and the Black situation, because in 1968, I don't think Irish Americans saw those parallels anymore. I think by the time you get to 1968, I mean, this is right before the busing crisis in American communities, in Boston in particular, which starts, I think, like 72. And so I think that Irish Americans and had so firmly become white and so firmly had assimilated within American culture that the idea that they could be, that their situation and their history could be in any way aligned with Black America and what was happening here was offensive. I spoke to Eamon McCann last year, actually. He visited my class on Zoom and we were talking about his book. And he said when he came to America to do talks, he had all these talks lined up with Irish American groups. And once he aligned himself with the Panthers, many of those talks were canceled. So yes, to me, it's obvious. Looking back historically, there's definitely a parallel there. There's definitely something for me, especially in my work, this is something I'm interested in. And this is the same thing happened with Bernadette Dublin. Yes. And this is something that I want to explore. But I think at the moment that this was happening, Irish Americans were offended by saying that they had anything in common with Black Americans.
Yeah, I guess I'm thinking in terms of the critics themselves, particularly when the film says we're an adaptation of The Informer, right? And so the critics, Ebert, Morgenstern, aren't Irish American. No. So I'm curious as to this broader ideological blindfold that it seems some must have had, if not to, it's perhaps not, wasn't that they couldn't see a particular kind of parallel, but they thought it illegitimate. As it seemed to suggest in the clips that you referenced, that would be giving too much presence or force to what was going on in Black communities to even dare equate it with this revolutionary struggle, the outcome of which is already known.
But I mean, even now when I've talked about my work, when I first started talking about my work, I received a lot of resistance. I think also, so not only is it coming from an Irish American framework, but it's also coming with a framework that the Black story is particularly unique as well, right, Kimberly? So that some people also are offended by any sort of analogous discussion between their history and their story and being compared to another, even though the two moments and the two movements have intertwined with each other. So from like Ebert's perspective, whose wife was Black, who sees a Black community, I wonder if from his perspective, if he sees them trying to take something, I don't know, more valued in a sense, and trying to elevate Black culture in that sense. And from the Morgenstern perspective or other critics that had his point of view, it really seems that they were focused on the Irish as white. And I guess that's why I referenced Irish American community, because when they became a part of the white community, other white Americans felt strongly towards that. And so to connect, an ethnic white community with Black America, I think in general, I think it was seen as offensive, but I don't know. I mean, but that's what I would guess.
Yeah, thanks. Interesting.
I would say that maybe if you look on the very local level at some places, like for example the transport workers union in New York City, which was a bunch of leftist Irish people, although that was more the rank and file than the leadership, long story, communist purge, etc. But that there was a lot, like there were actually a lot of Black members of the transport workers union, so there must have been some kind of like on an eye level political discourse going on around like those parallel situations. I just don't know, where would we find that archive? I suppose in the TW archive, which is here at NYU.
I'm not really sure. I mean, I think on the ground, I think people were relating to each other. But when you're talking about the larger structure, when you're talking about critics speaking to an American movement, I think from some perspective, Black activists wanted to separate themselves entirely from what other activists were doing. And I also think that white Americans just were reluctant to see a parallel within the Black community from any level. So I think on the ground, though, absolutely. And I'm not sure.
it's interesting when you look at the radical ministers, like there was one very radical Lutheran minister in Ohio, and there's a film about him called A Time for Burning. He tried to integrate with the Black Lutherans in the same city, and it didn't work. The churches ended up not being able to do it. But those were all Protestant denominations. Yeah. And I think there probably were individual Catholic priests who were involved. There's a spectrum. But the religious factor seems to be more skewed towards the Methodists, partly because of the tradition of Protestant, like Methodism and like the Black Church.
Perhaps, I'm not sure. Lauren Unke, who also has done work on Black Irish connection, she asked about if I mentioned the Huff as a site of uprising in 1966, yes. So in 1966, and I don't have a lot of information on what happened, but it's a devastated community. And so this is where the film takes place, and where they're looking at UpTight, and where they've placed UpTight, and they use the site of an uprising that happened in 1966, where I believe four people were killed. And at the time, Black activists were blamed for what was happening. And then we look back and we can see that what was happening was, this is a devastated community that was unraveling. So 2 years before the country began unraveling.
There's a line of dialogue in the film about it. Near the beginning, I think. So what is in the Schomburg archive? Is it just the shooting script, or do you also have memoranda? Is the collection, the Julian collection, a nice juicy one?
It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. I've only been once, like for a 1 week period. I hope to get back. But I mean, also because Julian Mayfield was brought into the project by Ruby Dee as a writer. Julian Mayfield was a writer in the 20th century. And he actually had been in Ghana, and he was an activist. So he was sort of exiled as well. And he comes back for the film. Ruby Dee suggest him as a writer because Dassin wanted either Ozzie Davis or James Earl Jones to play Tank. And Ozzie Davis was busy on another project, and I believe that James Earl Jones was as well. And so what happened was they asked Julian Mayfield to help with the writing. And then as they're working on the writing, they asked him to do the part as Tank as well. So it's interesting to see the letters. Like, I didn't really get to look at Ozzie Davis and Ruby Dee's archive too much, even though it's there, but to see correspondence between Ruby Dee and Julian Mayfield. I mean, they really helped to write and develop this script. And so there's correspondence between the two of them talking about what's happening in the film, you know, what their ideas are. And they're also working with Dassin to create shoots and to create what they think. They're taking notes from actors and incorporating that into the discussion. It's really fascinating to see how, I mean, just from the archival perspective, how they participated in making of this film. It's also interesting too, because the critic Cism is really bad, right, overall. But in Paramount, I guess, Ruby Dee said at the 2008 festival, she actually said that Paramount wanted to just pull the film and not, after it was made, they were like, I don't think we should show this. You know, and also a lot happened. 1968 was a busy year. And so by December, they were like thinking about pulling the film. And so Dassin said, you know, please don't, let's put it out there. And so you can also see that Paramount had put money into the film. There's, in at least from Mayfield's archives, there's a lot of material there from Paramount talking about touring and where it's screening. It's screened at the Roxy Theater in Boston. There was a lot there was an attempt to successfully sell this film. I think what happened though, I don't think they knew how to sell the film also. I mean, they tried to pitch it as a radical film from one perspective. And I think I was reading a review by I can't remember the name at the time, but one of the 1960s Black activists. And she was like, this, you can't show our revolution on film. This isn't how it's going to work. It wasn't revolutionary enough. I think there was a certain audience, like we saw from a white audience, that didn't understand a parallel situation between the Blacks and Irish and didn't understand what the statement the film was trying to make. But there were some people that enjoyed the film. And I would say that they related to it. And that was a small Black audience of the film.
It's pretty revolutionary, and then Blaxploitation becomes a big genre like around 1972. So it's sort of it's anticipating a movement in its style at the very least. I mean, those directors also had their own style.
And that's the other thing, is that it predates Blaxploitation, like, you know, by a couple of years, but it's often historically referred to as a Black exploitative film, which it isn't. It's not Blaxploitation. Yeah. So it was made at this moment that, I mean, I think it really captures 1968 and captures what happened during that year in a very interesting and provocative way. But I think because of the times, it just kind of fell outside of the scope of what people were interested in, you know. And then also being made by Dassin, I don't think people were really aware of that, how much Ruby Dee and Julian Mayfield contributed to this project. Julian Mayfield also, as a writer, his novels aren't really read that much anymore. So his participation in the film, you know, I don't think they understand the significance of it. Kimberly, you had a question.
Kim.
Yeah, in some ways this takes us a little away from the film itself, but continues the themes of what you've been discussing. And I'm really curious how your work has been received in the spaces in which you're moving as a scholar, you know, in Irish studies or vis-a-vis African-American studies. And if in some way it parallels the kinds of inabilities to see the connections between African-American cultural expression or politics, social life, and the Irish. Can you speak to that a little?
Yeah, it depends on where I'm at. There's some communities and there's some places where I've been very well received, and the work that I'm doing in looking at the parallels between Black history and literature and Irish history and literature, people are excited about and want to learn more. There's a lot of people though in certain communities and certain who haven't been as receptive to my work, who, like the reviewers of Uptight in 1968, don't see the parallels as important and think I'm de-emphasizing the importance of both situations by aligning them together. But I'm excited about what I'm doing. With each project, I'm learning more about how it's Irish and it's typically Irish, not Irish American, but Irish and Black artists have talked to each other. You know, I call it the transatlantic gesture, and they've really built on each other's work. So where you have Irish authors and activists looking to America and taking something that Black Americans did and try and doing something else with it. You also have Black Americans and Black artists taking Irish projects such as UpTight and doing something different with it. And in each instance, making it their own, right? Those Irish projects still are Irish, even though they have a Black American subtext, as is this project. Like I UpTight is a Black film in my perspective, even though it has these Irish roots. So it's been a mix as well. So I understand. I understand how UpTight was received.
Yeah.
There's one other character in the film that I just wanted to talk about. Oh yeah, Lauren Onkey is mentioning the fantastic soundtrack by Booker T and the MGs. It's really, really good. I didn't know it was on. I'm gonna download that somehow. I think the film, the idea of the informer is really complicated in the film UpTight, because there's a primary informer who is this gay Shakespeare quoting guy who is named Daisy, and it's a very unrealistic, because he hangs out with the police, like in a way that we wouldn't imagine to be kind of what was going on. And he's, as an adaptation, I think, from
you've completely
sort of Shirley Clarke's film, Jason. Oh, sorry. Can you hear me now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That character is a pastiche of a Baldwin-like, James Baldwin-like gay man. Something like the character of Jason in Shirley Clarke's film Portrait of Jason, which came out a year or two before UpTight. And he's a total new addition. I mean, he doesn't seem to have a kind of counterpart exactly, or am I wrong about that?
No.
Would you say that he does have a counterpart?
So he and Teddy, the white character that we were referring to when we first started talking, are both additions that belong only to UpTight. And I really don't know what to make of either one of them. I mean, the addition of Teddy's character as and the embodiment of Dasein himself is an interesting perspective for you to bring up. And that it makes sense in some ways, because at one point in the movie, Teddy says, "You can't do it without me." And there's this interesting moment actually when Teddy calls back to the committee and he's trying to let them know that the police are on their way to get Johnny. And if they had taken his call, Johnny might still be alive. They could have saved Johnny. And so I always wonder, it's like, is that true? Is that what the film is saying? You know, you really can't do it without the help of white liberals. Like, we can't divide. Now with Daisy, I don't know what he functions as. I mean, he's the one that pushes Tink to inform as well. He also kind of puts, so not only does Tink feel, you know, ostracized by the committee and betrayed by Johnny, but he also feels pressure from Daisy, because as a police informative, he has pictures of him, you know, committing another crime at a rally. And so I don't know what to make of him. I mean, it's definitely a problematic character. It definitely speaks to the history of how queer people have been accepted within African American community. And to make him the stool pigeon, he also, you know, he refers to himself as the an expletive. He is very, and he's also very flamboyant. Now, the actor Roscoe is brilliant, but if the character is unnecessary, right? And so it's an interesting addition. There's those two additions that aren't in the book or the previous film. And it's like, well,
yeah,
Teddy makes sense, but why Daisy?
Okay. Yeah, he's kind of like James Baldwin, and he's kind of like this Jason character as well.
Yeah.
And William Nevin wants to know about whether other kinds of films, like whether people were comparing it with Melvin Van Peebles' work. Did Melvin Van Peebles make any comments about UpTight or Spike Lee? I would say they probably haven't.
Not that I'm aware of.
You said in your paper.
Not that I'm aware. Barry Jenkins recently did a profile on UpTight, and he did it for Criterion on TV, and some of the information that he delivered in regards to the film and Ruby Dee is inaccurate. So I want to say that no, like I don't know. I can't speak for Spike Lee or Melvin Van Peebles, but I'm not aware of criticism or information that they have said or made comments about UpTight. It really, I think it premiered in 68 and, you know, it was around for maybe part of 69 and I think it disappeared.
Can I just come in here, folks?
Well, go ahead. Yes.
Sorry, Anna. We're just coming towards the end of the session. We are going, I think we'll continue this theme. I know we'll continue this theme a little bit, in particular in our second panel this afternoon. But Chanté, thank you for a fabulous, so great to see the clips and a really interesting topic and bringing a new dimension to the conference at this time in the day. And Anna, thank you for moderating it so nicely and for being part of this session. It's really great, always great to work with you. We're really, really grateful. And I just want to give a shout out. I know Mary Pat Kelly is on the line here with us, and Mary Pat, as someone who's worked on these themes for a long time, and given that we just recently celebrated Veterans Day, I want to remind people of Mary Pat's film Proud, which was a feature film starring Ossie Davis and Stephen Ray. And it's the story of the men of the USS Mason, the only African-American sailors to take a Navy warship into combat during World War II. And I just want to give a shout out for the week that's in it and to commend Mary Pat for her work in this topic. And Chanté, of course, Schomburg, there's a Schomburg connection later in the afternoon, actually at 2:00. So when we reconvene in about 45 minutes, the director of Schomburg, Joy Bivens, will introduce our panel from the Tenement Museum, which is going to look at this wonderful programming and tour that they're developing on the intersectionality of the African-American and Irish experience in 19th century New York. We've the director of the Tenement Museum, Annie Polland, Leslie Harris, a scholar from Northwestern University, and David Favarolo from Tenement Museum. Dr. Bivens from NYPL Schomburg is going to introduce that session. And then later in the afternoon, I know Lauren Onkey is on here. Lauren, and she sends her regards there, I see in the chat, with our own Mick Maloney, our great friend Lenny Sloan, moderated by William Bill Ferris, eminent folklorist, emeritus professor from the University of North Carolina, and moderated by our own John Waters. That begins at 3:45 Eastern time. So catch your breath. Congratulations again, Chanté, to more conversation. And thanks again, Anna. And we'll see you all back here in about 45 minutes' time.